Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents American Political Parties, Why They Formed, How They Function, and Where They're Headed, by John Kenneth White and Matthew R. Kerbel, narrated by Stephen Bowlby. Preface: How We Got Here. There is reason to worry that our 200-plus-year experiment with democracy is in danger. On January 6, 2021, insurrectionists invaded the U.S. Capitol, interrupting the official congressional certification of the 2020 electoral vote and Joe Biden's victory. Then-President Donald Trump successfully encouraged protesters to march from the White House to the Capitol and disrupt the solemn proceedings, and unsuccessfully urged his vice president, Mike Pence, to refuse to certify enough electoral votes to reverse the election outcome. As demonstrators neared the House and Senate chambers, members of Congress were hustled to secure locations, while Capitol Police, National Guard, and Washington, D.C. police officers fought the rioters, often in hand-to-hand combat. For the first time in U.S. history, a sitting president was accused of inciting an insurrection that, if successful, would have led to a constitutional crisis the likes of which Americans have never before seen. The Republican and Democratic parties were obvious sources of blame for this discord, especially from those who questioned the election result after their passions were inflamed by Donald Trump. Deep fissures in our politics are reflected in sharp divisions between the political parties. A metaphorical canyon divided Republicans from Democrats in 2020, with 85% of Trump and Biden supporters each saying the other side did not understand them. Foreign actors, especially Russia, were accused of using social media to inflame these tensions by planting false narratives designed to cause chaos and exacerbate social divisions. Consequently, partisan animosity boiled over. This hostility may feel extreme, but it is not new. In fact, it goes back to the very beginning of the Constitutional Republic. George Washington understood the problems partisanship could create, and in his 1796 farewell address, Washington denounced the spirit of party in words that have an eerily contemporary ring. This spirit, unfortunately, is inseparable from our nature, having its root in the strongest passions of the human mind. The disorders and miseries which result gradually incline the minds of men to seek security and repose in the absolute power of an individual, and sooner or later, the chief of some prevailing faction, more able or more fortunate than his competitors, turns this disposition to the purposes of his own elevation on the ruins of public liberty. The spirit of party serves always to distract the public councils and enfeeble the public administration. It agitates the community with ill-founded jealousies and false alarms, kindles the animosity of one part against another, foments occasionally riot and insurrection. It opens the door to foreign influence and corruption, which finds a facilitated access to the government itself through the channels of party passions. Thus, the policy and the will of one country are subjected to the policy and will of another. Washington's wish for an apolitical, unified nation did not come to pass. Instead, parties became pillars of American political and social life. Fledgling parties vigorously contested the presidential elections of 1796 and 1800, resulting in division, chaos, and contested results. As parties became more ingrained in the American psyche and later enshrined into election law, a two-party system took root. Soon, it became impossible to imagine the political system functioning without parties. Partisan newspapers became features of public life, conveying the positions of the earliest American parties to their supporters. Later, the two major parties acted as vital agents of political socialization for a wave of Irish immigrants in the 1840s and a historic number of European migrants in the 1890s. George Washington Plunkett, boss of New York City's infamous Tammany Hall machine, candidly told a reporter in 1905 how he wooed young men into his Democratic organization.
I hear of a young fellow that's proud of his voice, thinks he can sing fine. I ask him to come around to Washington Hall and join our glee club. He comes and sings, and he's a follower of Plunkett for life. Another young feller gains a reputation as a baseball player in a vacant lot. I bring him into our baseball club. That fixes him. You'll find him working for my ticket at the polls next election day. And then there's the feller that likes rowing on the river, the young feller that makes a name as a waltzer on his block, the young feller that's handy with his dukes. I rope them all in by giving them opportunities to show themselves off. I don't trouble them with political arguments. I just study human nature and act accordin'.
During the 19th century, presidents were often secondary in prominence to local and state party leaders, who doled out thousands of patronage jobs to their most loyal supporters, positions that often made the difference between prosperity and ruin. But party influence wasn't always about jobs. Party leaders were vital intermediaries, assisting those in trouble with the law, providing aid to victims of fire or some other tragedy, and creating fraternal organizations or other social outlets. Former First Lady Michelle Obama remembers how her father, Fraser Robinson, acquired his patronage job at the Chicago Water Filtration Plant and, in return, served as a neighborhood precinct captain. Obama writes, "He'd held the post for years, in part because loyal service to the party machine was more or less expected of city employees. Even if he'd been half forced into it, though, my dad loved the job, which baffled my mother given the amount of time it demanded. He paid weekend visits to a nearby neighborhood to check in on his constituents, often with me, reluctantly, in tow. When somebody had problems with garbage pickup or snow plowing or was irritated by a pothole, my dad was there to listen. His purpose was to help people feel cared for by the Democrats and to vote accordingly when elections rolled around." Time eroded the power of these local party organizations as an expanding civil service substantially reduced the number of patronage jobs. Today, national party organizations like the Democratic National Committee, Republican National Committee, and their congressional counterparts have subsumed the once powerful party bosses to dominate national and frequently state politics. This centralization of party power coincides with a partisanship that sees fewer voters split their tickets between Democrats and Republicans, more citizens contributing small dollar amounts to the national parties and candidates of their choice, and opportunities for wealthy individuals to contribute vast sums without any public attribution, a phenomenon known as dark money. Party identification has become the most important factor in how people vote, transforming elections into a kind of political Armageddon. After the 2020 contest, 66% said it was either the single most important election or one of the most important in their lifetimes. The partisanship we live with today can be traced back to different views of American government that divided the nation's founders. Alexander Hamilton and Thomas Jefferson, two members of George Washington's first cabinet, were adversaries whose differences were so contentious they eventually caused each to resign. Hamilton believed that freedom was a peculiarly American trait, but needed to be paired with a strong central government led by a strong executive to prevent it from running amok. Jefferson also believed freedom to be a core American value, but he felt it could only be preserved by local civic virtue nurtured in the absence of a strong central government. In Jefferson's view, there were substantial differences among the states, and local authorities should have the power to determine what works best in their communities. For more than two centuries, the debate initiated by Hamilton and Jefferson about the size and role of government has imperfectly but consistently shaped partisan divisions. Although the issues separating the two sides have changed and changed again, the central tenets of their disagreement have not. Since the Democratic and Republican parties began regularly competing with each other after 1860, each party has, at times, embraced elements of the Hamiltonian and Jeffersonian positions. In the late 19th century, Democrats advanced agrarian interests by advocating Jeffersonian localism
while Republicans promoted a rapidly nationalizing industrial sector. Then, during the Great Depression, Democrats became the party of Hamiltonian nationalism and oversaw an unprecedented expansion of the national social welfare state. In the late 20th century, Republican Ronald Reagan gave voice to Jefferson's ideal of local control, even as he presided over an expansion of the federal government. Subsequently, Bill Clinton bowed to the popularity of Reagan's appeal and modified the Democrats' Hamiltonian stance of relying on government to solve problems, going so far as to declare that the era of big government is over. In their current incarnation, Democrats align more with Hamilton and his approach to vesting major responsibilities in a federal government that can respond to the exigencies of the moment. This is particularly true in a post-COVID-19 world, where Joe Biden and his fellow Democrats want to use federal power to address looming crises, be it with direct relief for those displaced by the pandemic, investing in physical and human infrastructure, or dealing with climate change. Republicans, in turn, have long advocated limited government with less taxation and regulation, defending Donald Trump's tax cuts and viewing states and localities as the appropriate locus of government activity. Congressional Republicans unanimously opposed Biden's American Families Plan to deal with COVID-19 that included direct payments to families and child care tax credits, and largely opposed his American Jobs Plan and American Families Plan designed to rebuild the nation's crumbling infrastructure and expand the social safety net. They are backed in these efforts by rank-and-file Republicans. After the 2020 election, 62% of Trump voters said congressional Republicans should do their best to stand up to Biden on major policies, even if it means little gets passed. One reason why the parties have not been steadfast in their embrace of the Hamiltonian or Jeffersonian position is that Americans prefer some combination of both. Bill Clinton drew this simple analogy between Jefferson's embrace of liberty and Hamilton's advocacy for community. Take a penny from your pocket. On one side next to Lincoln's portrait is a single word, liberty. On the other side is our national motto. It says, E pluribus unum, out of many, one. It does not say, every man for himself. That humble penny is an explicit declaration, one you can carry around in your pocket, that America is about both individual liberty and community obligation. These two commitments, to protect personal freedom and to seek common ground, are the coin of our realm, the measure of our worth. Nevertheless, the political parties have often forced Americans to choose one side or the other, sometimes resulting in their hatred for both. Herbert Croly argued that Hamilton perverted the national idea as much as Jefferson perverted the American democratic idea. And the proper relation of these two fundamental conceptions, one to another, cannot be completely understood until this double perversion is corrected. Thus, there have been historic oscillations as both parties adjusted their perspectives as to whether Hamilton's emphasis on authority and a strong federal government, or Jefferson's preference for a de-evolution of power to state and local officials, meets the moment. Often, Americans want both, even if they can't have both. The Hamilton-Jefferson debate has even extended to what parties should look like and how they should act. Hamilton's preference for a strong, centralized approach to politics has seen both parties become much stronger at the national level in terms of organization and money, sometimes using these resources to shape elections at the state level. Yet when it comes to selecting their presidential candidates, the party establishments have weakened. Democrats have long been unable to dictate their party's nominee, allowing primary voters to make that decision since 1972. Historically, Republicans deferred to their party's leaders to select their presidential candidates until Donald Trump smashed whatever power a weakened national Republican establishment retained. Indeed, Trump's go-it-alone, one-man control over the GOP, even in his post-presidency, is unlike anything we have ever witnessed. Even past strong presidents, Franklin D. Roosevelt comes to mind, had to defer to party bosses whenever the situation required. Thus, even when they had been sympathetic to Jefferson's preference for a weak national government, organizationally, the parties have transformed themselves into national behemoths that Hamilton might have welcomed. Still, the groups that identify with the two parties are very different. Democrats have a multicultural appeal and a broad, at times unwieldy, coalition that includes progressive, liberal, and moderate elements. This diversity of supporters can complicate governance when the party holds power, especially when it has exceptionally narrow congressional majorities, like it did following the 2020 election. Republicans are more monolithic, especially since Donald Trump took control of the party rank and file, although there are differing opinions as to whether Trump's position as a modern-day party boss will last. Outright near-unanimous Republican opposition to Joe Biden in the early days of his presidency put tremendous pressure on the Democratic coalition to hold together despite internal differences. This book tells the story of American political parties, why they formed, how they function, and where they are headed. It is a saga filled with many twists and turns, surprises, and uncertain outcomes along the lines sketched out between Alexander Hamilton and Thomas Jefferson. Chapter 1 describes in greater detail the emergence of the arguments developed by Hamilton and Jefferson about the appropriate scope and nature of the federal government, which have reverberated through the long history of political parties in America and provide the backdrop for the discussion in this book. Chapter 2 details the first century of American political party development and explores how parties forged a uniquely American character while adapting to new times and technologies. Chapter 3 takes this history into the 20th and 21st centuries, focusing on forces that molded party organizations into powerful institutions at the turn of the 20th, and on forces that eroded and then helped rebuild them at the turn of the 21st. Chapter 4 describes the ongoing evolution in how parties choose their presidential nominees, with an emphasis on how the rise of personality politics and the emergence of social media have shaped nomination politics and undermined formerly powerful party organizations. Chapter 5 notes how party loyalties can strengthen during periods of realignment, when new coalitions of voters upend previous political coalitions, and erode during periods of de-alignment, when independent voters become decisive in elections. Chapter 6 looks closely at the challenges posed to parties by social media. Chapter 7 explores the importance of money in politics, examines the current state of campaign finance laws, or lack thereof, and considers how the internet and mega-wealthy individuals have revolutionized fundraising. Chapter 8 examines the role of the party in government, including the importance of the national party organizations. Chapter 9 looks at the role of third parties in the American two-party system and notes that at key junctures, they have helped the major parties adjust to changing public demands. We conclude by considering what lies ahead for a party system that appears to be buckling under the weight of a rapidly changing America. In its complexity and entirety, the saga of the U.S. party system is fascinating because of the continued evolution of its actors. With each election, we learn more about how the two major parties address the eternal and emerging questions of our politics. We will begin most naturally with an election like no other in our lifetimes, the extraordinary story of 2020, and how partisan combat and its aftermath upset centuries-old norms of party behavior while bringing the republic itself to the brink. While the 2020 election and its aftermath add an important chapter to our story, as we note in the conclusion, the final ending has yet to be written. Introduction. An election like no other. We've never witnessed anything like the 2020 election and its aftermath, where the centrist tendencies essential to the success of the American two-party system gave way to a politics of absolutism that manifested in an insurrection against the government. Consider the extraordinary events of late 2020 and early 2021, when the expectations of a peaceful transfer of power were superseded by partisan violence. It was a moment of outsized participation marked by great partisan energy, when 159 million Americans voted in person or by mail amidst a once-in-a-century pandemic. After days of counting ballots, Joe Biden emerged as the winner, having secured 306 electoral votes to Donald Trump's 232. This was a devastating loss for Republicans, who, in the space of just 4 years, had surrendered the presidency, House, and Senate, the first time that had happened to the party since Herbert Hoover was defeated for re-election in 1932. But the counting of the ballots marked only the beginning of an unprecedented moment in American history. On January 6, 2021, President Trump incited a crowd to stop the official certification of the electoral votes by a joint session of Congress. Inflamed by Trump's rhetoric that urged his supporters to fight like hell, because if you don't fight like hell, you're not going to have a country anymore, thousands marched from the White House and stormed the Capitol. Armed with guns, bear spray, zip ties, and other weapons, the rioters constructed a makeshift gallows on the Capitol grounds intended for congressional leaders, including Vice President Mike Pence and House Speaker Nancy Pelosi. Members of Congress scrambled to get out of harm's way and into secure locations, while congressional staffers barricaded their offices, hid under conference tables, and feared for their lives. 5 people died during the insurrection, including 1 Capitol Police officer. 2 officers perished by suicide shortly afterward. 1 week later, the House of Representatives impeached Trump for a second time. House Democrats were unanimous in their support for impeachment, and they were joined by 10 Republicans, including the #3 GOP leader, Wyoming Congresswoman Liz Cheney, the daughter of a former Republican vice president. Following a Senate trial held just days after Trump left office in February 2021, 57 senators voted to convict the former president, including 7 Republicans. Despite falling 10 votes short of the 2/3 needed for conviction, it was the most bipartisan judgment ever leveled in an impeachment trial and marked the first time that multiple members of a president's party supported conviction. Inaugurated as the nation's 46th president 2 weeks after the attempted insurrection, Joe Biden made a plea for an American democracy that he called precious yet fragile. He was not the first or only figure to take note of the tenuous nature of the American political system during a fraught moment in history. Former President Barack Obama saw an American system of government under siege. America as an experiment is genuinely important to the world, not because of the accidents of history that made us the most powerful nation on Earth, but because America is the first real experiment in building a large, multi-ethnic, multicultural democracy. And we don't know yet if that can hold. There haven't been enough of them to say for certain that it's going to work. Lara Trump, the former president's daughter-in-law, saw the zero-sum stakes of the 2020 election this way. This is not just a choice between Republican and Democrat, or left and right. This is an election that will decide if we keep America, America, or if we head down an uncharted, frightening path towards socialism. Biden struck a hopeful tone at his inauguration, but the proceedings were set against the threat of additional violence and a pandemic that, by then, had already killed more Americans than all of those who died during World War II. Ringed by thousands of troops, Biden took the presidential oath just hours after Donald Trump departed Washington, D.C. for his Florida estate. For the first time since Andrew Johnson refused to attend the inauguration of Ulysses S. Grant in 1869, a departing chief executive was nowhere to be found on the inaugural platform. It was a symbolic statement about resistance to the peaceful transfer of power that echoed the rebellion days before. The only other comparable precedent was 1801, the first time an American political party handed over the reins of government to its opposition, when Thomas Jefferson was sworn into office just hours after the defeated John Adams decamped for his native Massachusetts. Like 2020, The Adams-Jefferson contest of 1800 was an ugly, highly partisan affair with ramifications for the continuity of government. Federalist John Adams loathed Democrat Thomas Jefferson, who, in turn, lambasted his opponent for approving the Alien and Sedition Acts, which made criticism of the president a crime and handed pro-Jefferson newspaper editorialists in jail. One Jefferson supporter captured the election's importance. To reign by fear and not by affection was ever bad policy. I am confident that the people of America are too fond of freedom to surrender it passively, and that whenever any body of men disclose views inimical to their interests, they will hurl them into insignificance. Like 2020, the contentious election of 1800 was followed by an even more contentious aftermath. Owing to an electoral college mechanism that didn't account for the emergence of political parties, Thomas Jefferson's running mate, Aaron Burr, won an equal number of votes to Jefferson in the electoral college. Under the Constitution, the House of Representatives had to resolve the matter. Controlled by the Federalist Party, whose most well-known public spokesperson was Alexander Hamilton, members of the congressional majority were confronted with an unappetizing choice. Which of their rivals would they select to be the next president? After a weeks-long deadlock and with Hamilton's endorsement, the Federalist House chose Jefferson as the lesser of two evils. Adams left office, but a period of political vitriol followed. 4 years later, Burr assassinated Hamilton in a duel. Within a decade, the Federalist Party itself devolved into political insignificance. The election of 1800 and John Adams's acceptance of defeat created what James McGregor Burns described as a vital extra-constitutional right, the peaceful transition from a party in power to its opposition. Burns noted that this customary transfer of power from one political party to another, one that still eludes many other nations, showcased America at its best. A crucial liberty, one that had not been tested during the 12-year hegemony of Federalist government, was established in the election of 1800, the freedom of the opposition not only to oppose, but to prevail peacefully. Not only did this constitute evidence to the world that the American polity was far more stable than it may have appeared, it was a notice to future American political leaders that they need not contemplate coups or venture violence in order to succeed. Much to the contrary, the path to political power in the United States was shown to lead directly to and through the ballot box, ensuring for generations to come the freedom of meaningful political opposition and the regular, orderly, peaceful transfer of political power. This peaceful transfer of power and acceptance of constitutional norms shaped how American political parties developed around a set of democratic values. Lewis Hartz, a political theorist best known for his commentary on American political culture, maintained that the United States had achieved a national consensus centered on the importance of individual freedoms. It is a remarkable force, this fixed dogmatic liberalism of a liberal way of life. It is the secret root from which have sprung many of the most puzzling aspects of American cultural phenomena. Englishman G.K. Chesterton wrote in 1920 that the United States was founded on a creed, saying, "That creed is set forth with dogmatic and even theological lucidity in the Declaration of Independence, perhaps the only piece of practical politics that is also theoretical politics and also great literature." This creed allowed for little tolerance of extremes and was decidedly centrist in nature. Lewis Cass, the 1848 Democratic nominee for president, once told a Tammany Hall audience of party bosses in New York City that he was opposed to all the isms of the day, like communism and socialism. Abraham Lincoln warned that if the Declaration of Independence were amended to read that all men are created equal except Negroes, foreigners, and Catholics, then I should prefer emigrating to some country where they make no pretense of loving liberty, to Russia, for instance, where despotism can be taken pure and without the base alloy of hypocrisy. The American penchant for middle-of-the-road politics formed a foundation for our two-party system. President Dwight Eisenhower once noted, "There is, in our affairs at home, a middle way between untrammeled freedom of the individual and the demands for the welfare of the whole nation. This way must avoid government by bureaucracy as carefully as it avoids neglect of the helpless." The search for the middle led to the development of two broad parties, a phenomenon that happened almost simultaneously with the adoption of the U.S. Constitution. Although the names and allegiances of the parties have changed many times, a two-party system with its origins in the formative years of American political parties has endured for more than two centuries. As political scientist V.O. Key observed, "Human institutions have an impressive capacity to perpetuate themselves, or at least to preserve their form. The circumstances that happened to mold the American party system into a dual form at its inception must bear a degree of responsibility for its present existence." As the two-party system began to form, a public consensus about the boundaries of political debate formed with it. The product of the disagreements between Hamilton and Jefferson and their influence as party leaders. They established the parameters of conflict that would take place between two dominant parties by posing and answering several key questions. 1. How do we limit our freedoms and still possess them? 2. How much government should we have, and when is it too excessive? 3. When do we need a national government to act in the interests of all our citizens? 4. When is it appropriate to leave matters to local customs and practices? Hamilton believed that Americans were inextricably linked by a common bond of citizenship that required action by the federal government, and especially the president, when times demanded it. Writing in The Federalist, Hamilton observed, "Energy in the executive is a leading character in the definition of good government." Hamilton added that energetic executives were essential to the protection of the community against foreign attacks, as well as the steady administration of the laws to the protection of property against those irregular and high-handed combinations which sometimes interrupt the ordinary course of justice, to the security of liberty against the enterprises and assaults of ambition, of faction, and of anarchy. For Hamilton, the best presidents were proactive executives who protected individual rights and acted on behalf of the nation. Thomas Jefferson, on the other hand, preferred a more limited federal role, believing local communities should take the lead and act in the citizens' best interests, and that the nation's diversity meant that different states and locales would choose different alternatives. In 1825, Jefferson warned about the expanding power of government and believed that the salvation of the republic rested on the regeneration and spread of the New England town hall meeting. As two-party competition developed between Democrats and Republicans, vigorous debates emerged between them revolving around these polls. From time to time, the leading parties shifted positions. Democrats began their storied history as devotees of Jeffersonian localism, espousing the doctrine of states' rights. Republicans initially staked their political fortunes on a Hamiltonian nationalism that would keep the Union together amidst a civil war. Later, Republicans espoused building railroads, creating land-grant colleges and universities, and giving the federal government a powerful voice in protecting industrial workers as the nation's economy shifted from an agricultural to an industrial base. The Great Depression altered the party's accustomed roles. Democrats, led by Franklin D. Roosevelt, wanted the federal government to bring relief to the nation's unemployed and provide greater economic security, including passage of Social Security. Republicans took Jefferson's side, believing that Roosevelt's New Deal programs infringed individual freedoms and threatened the sanctity of local rule. The parties never quite played their assigned roles perfectly. During the Eisenhower years, Republicans presided over a massive expansion of the federal government, including creating the nation's interstate highways. In the Clinton years, Democrats scaled back their expectations about what the federal government can and should do. Complicating matters is the tendency for the public to want some combination of Hamiltonian nationalism
and Jeffersonian localism. Journalist Walter Lippmann once observed that Americans did not like to choose between these two schools of thought. To be partisan, as between Jefferson and Hamilton, is like arguing whether men or women are more necessary to the procreation of the race. Neither can live alone. Alone, that is, without the other, each is excessive and soon intolerable. Throughout history, voters have reversed course when they perceive that one party offers too much government and the other too little. But if either Alexander Hamilton or Thomas Jefferson had come back to life at any point in the late 19th or 20th centuries, they would have recognized themselves in the tone of Democratic and Republican Party leaders. Now, however, after 4 years of the Donald Trump presidency, two impeachment trials, and political polarization that echoes the fracturing of the party system of the 1850s, there arises a question as to whether the public consensus recognized by political theorists and historians has come apart. Put another way, is the continuance of our two-party system assured, or will the Democrats and Republicans splinter into third and fourth parties? The question is a serious one. As previously noted, Lewis Cass, the 1848 Democratic presidential nominee, embraced moderation by rejecting all the extreme isms of his day. But the Trump presidency was built on an important ism, populism, which sees the people, whom it purports to represent, as producers who personify the American dream, while its enemies are takers, that is, elites, immigrants, and those who reject conventional social mores. In its essence, populism is all about us versus them, the makers versus the takers. In 1995, political scientist Wilson Carey McWilliams noted that the populism of the right favors old hatred and creates new resentments, threatening what remains of civic community. It specifically threatens to undermine the moderation that makes the two-party system possible. Donald Trump was defeated in 2020, but the populist movement he leads is poised to define the Republican Party for the foreseeable future. Political commentator Michael Lind writes, "In the Republican Party, the inherited program shared by much of the conservative movement and the party's donors, with its emphasis on free trade and large-scale immigration, and cuts in entitlements like Social Security and Medicare, is a relic of the late 20th century, when the country club wing of the party was much more important than the country and western wing. The anger and sense of betrayal of the newly dominant white working class in the Republican Party makes perfect sense. Mr. Trump exposed the gap between what orthodox conservative Republicans offer and what today's dominant Republican voters actually want. Middle-class entitlements, plus crackdowns on illegal immigrants, Muslims, foreign trade rivals, and free-riding allies." Whenever populism ascends, rhetorical excess inevitably follows. Michael Kazin writes, "By calling the enemy an octopus, leech, pig, or fat cat, a populist speaker suggested that the people were opposing a form of savagery as much as a structure inimical to their interests. Character assassination was always essential to the rhetorical game." For 4 years, Donald Trump engaged in a form of character assassination on Twitter, replete with dismissive name-calling, for example, Crooked Hillary Clinton, Sleepy Joe Biden, and Crazy Nancy Pelosi. In 2016, Hillary Clinton charged that Trump built his campaign on prejudice and paranoia. "He is taking hate groups mainstream and helping a radical fringe take over the Republican Party." Clinton was prophetic, as white supremacists and armed militias staged the violent Capitol insurrection that resulted in mayhem and murder. Back in 1964, political scientist Richard Hofstadter anticipated contemporary populism by noting the emergence of a paranoid style that was beginning to creep into our political discourse. As a member of the avant-garde who is capable of perceiving the conspiracy before it is fully obvious to an as yet unaroused public, the paranoid is a militant leader. He does not see social conflict as something to be mediated and compromised in the manner of the working politician.
since what is at stake is always a conflict between absolute good and absolute evil. The quality needed is not a willingness to compromise, but the will to fight things out to a finish. Nothing but complete victory will do. Since the enemy is thought of as being totally evil and totally unappeasable, he must be totally eliminated, if not from the world, at least from the theater of operations to which the paranoid directs his attention. This demand for unqualified victories leads to the formation of hopelessly unrealistic goals. And since these goals are not even remotely attainable, failure constantly heightens the paranoid's frustration. Even partial success leaves him with the same sense of powerlessness with which he began. And this, in turn, only strengthens his awareness of the vast and terrifying quality of the enemy he opposes. Hofstadter's description of the paranoid style captures the qualities that underlay Donald Trump's appeal and his ability to remake the Republican Party in his image. As Donald Trump Jr. told the crowd gathered to hear his father prior to their storming of the Capitol, their presence should be a warning to those Republicans who wanted to certify the Electoral College votes. "This isn't their party anymore," he said. "This is Donald Trump's Republican Party." Trump Jr. was right. A poll taken immediately following Trump's second impeachment trial found 75% of Republicans wanted Trump to continue playing a prominent role in the Republican Party. 71% of Republicans believed impeaching and convicting the former president was an act of disloyalty. The result has been to strip the Republican Party of its conservative principles and stymie the development of conservative policies and programs. This became apparent in 2020 when the GOP followed Trump's instructions and readopted its 2016 platform without changing a word. It was an unprecedented action that left voters adrift as to what Trump and the Republican Party would do if he had won a second term. Democrats, as is customary, adopted a full-length party platform that defined their approach to the major issues of the day, including the COVID-19 pandemic, race relations and policing, immigration, climate change, and foreign policy. Republicans essentially expressed their loyalty to one man. 60 years ago, a committee of the American Political Science Association issued this prescient warning. When the president's program actually is the sole program, either his party becomes a flock of sheep or the party falls apart. In effect, this concept of the presidency disperses the party system by making the president reach directly for the support of a majority of the voters. It favors a president who exploits skillfully the arts of demagoguery, who sees the whole country as his political backyard, and who does not mind turning into the embodiment of personal government. History has shown that whenever populist grievances become dominant, populism itself descends into its own paranoid style and eventually recedes into the background. Donald Trump's takeover of the Republican Party has created its own unique politics of grievance and has brought many former white working-class Democrats who resent globalism and the country's changing political demography into their ranks. But the transformation of the Republican Party into a Trumpian populist entity threatens to eliminate the political consensus that has shaped American discourse for nearly three centuries and potentially the existence of the two-party system itself. The anger Republicans exhibit has spilled over into our civic life. Today, 55% of Republicans believe the traditional American way of life is disappearing so fast that we may have to use force to save it. 39% say that if elected leaders will not protect America, the people must do it themselves, even if it requires taking violent action. Even if Republicans remain out of power, the threat posed by right-wing populism to the survival of the party system is real. Party scholars often focus on the majority party, why it succeeds in gaining power, and what ideas it has to offer. But the minority party also plays a vital role in stable governance. It defines its disagreements with the majority, even as it selects those issues upon which they agree. Those disagreements, often filled with echoes of Hamilton and Jefferson, are presented to voters who determine which side they prefer. The minority party can also co-opt the development of third parties and simplify the choice voters must make. Back in 2014, Republican South Carolina Senator Lindsey Graham said, "The country needs a vibrant Republican Party." He was right. In politics, ideas matter and move nations, and a vibrant Republican Party would choose areas of disagreement with Democrats and offer policy alternatives. Today, ideas are in short supply as the Republican Party has abandoned its conservative principles to indulge in personality politics. Time will determine whether that lasts, but it calls into question if the long-standing consensus derived from the Hamilton-Jefferson debates will continue, or whether the two-party system is past its zenith. This is where the party system stands in the aftermath of the 2020 election. To understand how we got here, it is best to return to the beginning and look at the history of political party development in America, at how once weak political parties grew into the dominant institutions we know today. We will tell that story in the next two chapters, starting in Chapter 1 with an account of how nascent parties took root in what James McGregor Burns once described as the vineyard of liberty that characterized the early United States. Chapter 1. Hamilton versus Jefferson. How political parties began. The framers of the U.S. Constitution were well versed in the writings of Aristotle, Locke, Montesquieu, and other democratic thinkers. From their extensive reading of history, they understood the dangers of unchecked ambition and the necessities of free speech and minority protections that are so vital in creating a representative democracy. The tripartite system of government they devised, consisting of a president, Congress, and judiciary, has endured with only modest revisions to the U.S. Constitution. Upon leaving the presidency in 1796, George Washington urged that the Constitution be sacredly maintained, that its administration in every department may be stamped with wisdom and virtue. 42 years later, Abraham Lincoln told the Springfield, Illinois Young Men's Lyceum that the Constitution should become the political religion of the nation. Yet, while the framers realized success in establishing instruments of governance, they struggled over how to organize elections. Popular democratic elections were a novel experiment that many believed could not happen without widespread turmoil and violence. One Massachusetts delegate to the Constitutional Convention in Philadelphia contended that the evils we experience flow from the excess of democracy. Alexander Hamilton agreed. "The people are turbulent and changing. They seldom judge or determine right." By the 21st century, however, the excess of democracy had become universal. In 2017, there were 35,879 cities and townships, 12,880 independent school districts, 3,031 counties, and 38,266 special districts spread across the U.S., many with elected leaders. The Constitution's framers were skeptical of political parties, thinking of them as factions to be avoided. So, it was to their great astonishment that political parties proved to be the agents that made the document's provisions and the complex system of elections work. Parties afforded a way of organizing elections, legitimizing opposition, and guaranteeing peaceful transitions of power. Once in office, they often helped elected officials work together and bridged some of the differences both between and among government institutions. One might assume, therefore, that political parties would be welcome instruments of governance. Quite the contrary. For more than 200 years, Americans have steadfastly refused to embrace party-led government, preferring instead that their leaders act in a nonpartisan manner. In 1956, John F. Kennedy wrote a Pulitzer Prize-winning book, Profiles in Courage, which extolled those who placed conscience above party. 60 years later, Republican presidential nominee Donald Trump took a different tack, this time underscoring the public's distaste for both major parties. "We look at politicians and think, this one's owned by this millionaire, that one's owned by that millionaire, or lobbyist, or special group." Voters rewarded Trump's Republican Party by giving them complete control of the federal government in 2016. But their investment was fleeting. 2 years later, they soured on Trump's leadership and handed control of the House of Representatives to Democrats. 2 years after that, they gave Democrats the White House and Senate as well. The remainder of this chapter sets the foundation for our discussion of the evolution and role of political parties in America. We start by looking at the love-hate relationship Americans have with parties and how this has influenced party development. Next, we address what roles parties play and how they differ from other players in the political system. The chapter ends with a discussion of the disparate perspectives on political parties held by Hamilton and Jefferson, which will help to structure our understanding of party development. Political parties, institutions Americans love to hate. The Founding Fathers were elitists who wanted to minimize the role citizens would play in choosing their office holders. They were especially fearful of political parties, arguing that it was necessary, in Madison's words, to break and control the violence of faction, meaning parties and other special interest groups. James Madison, George Washington, Alexander Hamilton, John Adams, and Thomas Jefferson believed that an enlightened citizenry would have no use for parties. Instead of parties, Madison hoped other mediating institutions would refine and enlarge the public views by passing them through the medium of the chosen body of citizens, whose wisdom may best discern the true interest of their country, and whose patriotism and love of justice will be least likely to sacrifice it to temporary or partial conditions. Madison believed a multitude of interests would proliferate through continental expansion, thus making the development of large, mass-based parties virtually inconceivable. You make it less probable that a majority of the whole will have a common motive to invade the rights of other citizens, or if such a common motive exists, it will be more difficult for all who feel it to discover their own strength and to act in unison with each other. Madison's belief that parties were unsuited filters for mass expressions of public opinion was based on his reading of history. He believed human beings were emotional creatures, often embracing different religions and political leaders with a zealotry that usually ended in chaos and violence. Most of Madison's contemporaries agreed, and they despised political parties as vehicles that would, inevitably, ignite uncontrollable political passions. George Washington was especially critical of partisan demagogues whose objective, he claimed, was not to give people the facts from which they could reasonably make up their own minds, but to make them blind followers. In an early draft of a 1792 speech renouncing a second term, never delivered when he had a change of heart, Washington maintained that we are all children of the same country, and that our interest, however diversified in local and smaller matters, is the same in all the great and essential concerns of the nation. Determined to make good on his intention to leave office in 1796, Washington issued his famous farewell address, in which he admonished his fellow citizens to avoid partisanship at any cost, noting that the spirit of party caused great division and agitated passions that helped divide the nation. Washington was hardly alone in admonishing partisanship. 6 years before Washington's famous farewell and prior to the end of the Revolutionary War, John Adams bemoaned the country's elites' drift toward party politics. There is nothing I dread so much as a division of the Republic into two great parties, each arranged under its leader and converting measures in opposition to each other. Abigail Adams, observing the effects of partisan attacks on her husband during his presidency, wrote, "Party spirit is blind, malevolent, uncandid, ungenerous, unjust, and unforgiving." James Monroe, the nation's fifth chief executive, urged his backers to obliterate all party divisions. When Abraham Lincoln sought re-election in 1864 under the newly created National Union banner, 500,000 pamphlets were published bearing titles such as "No Party Now, But All for Our Country." Today's party leaders also seem skeptical about a place for parties in the American setting. In the keynote address that launched Barack Obama's national career at the 2004 Democratic National Convention, the future president spoke of the ills that stem from dividing the country into partisan groups. The pundits like to slice and dice our country into red states and blue states. Red states for Republicans, blue states for Democrats. But I've got news for them. We worship an awesome God in the blue states. And we don't like federal agents poking around our libraries in the red states. We coach Little League in the blue states and have gay friends in the red states. There are patriots who oppose the war in Iraq and patriots who supported it. We are one people, all of us pledging allegiance to the stars and stripes, all of us defending the United States of America. Because this message resonates with so many people, political figures often find it advantageous to downplay political labels. Seeking re-election in 1972, Richard Nixon instructed his staff not to include the word Republican in any of his television advertisements or campaign brochures. 4 years later, Gerald R. Ford was bluntly told by his advisors not to campaign for Republican candidates, lest his support erode among independents and ticket splitters. Asking Republicans and Republican-leaning voters in 2020 whether they considered themselves to be more a supporter of Donald Trump or more a supporter of the Republican Party, 52% labeled themselves Trump supporters first. Campaigning for re-election in 2020, Donald Trump mentioned the Republican Party only 5 times in his acceptance speech, twice referring to Abraham Lincoln, twice pledging to keep Americans safe from rioters and looters, and once to promise that the party would protect those with pre-existing health conditions should Obamacare be overturned by the Supreme Court. For his part, Joe Biden mentioned the Democratic Party just once and in a bipartisan context, saying, "While I will be the Democratic candidate, I will be an American president. I will work as hard for those who didn't support me as I will for those who did." Students of political parties, however, give them more kudos than the public. In his book, The American Commonwealth, published in 1888, James Bryce began a tradition of scholarly investigation of political parties by devoting more than 200 pages to the subject. His treatment was laudatory. Parties are inevitable. No free large country has been without them. No one has shown how representative government could be worked without them. They bring order out of chaos to a multitude of voters. More than a century later, scores of academicians agree with Bryce. In a 1996 amicus curiae, friend of the court brief, filed with the U.S. Supreme Court, the Committee for Party Renewal, a bipartisan group of political scientists, summarized the views held by most party scholars. Political parties play a unique and crucial role in our democratic system of government. Parties enable citizens to participate coherently in a system of government, allowing for a substantial number of...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.